Everybody, today I have brought for you the second part of chapter 1, the Indian Constitution. In the previous video, we discussed what is a constitution and why does a country need it. In this part, we are going to discuss the Indian Constitution particularly and the task started in December 1946 with the formation of Constituent Assembly. Before this, one time in 1934, the Indian National Congress demanded for the Constitution for India, but the demand was not accepted by the Britishers. When they decided to leave India, and at that time before leaving, they asked the Indians to form a constituent assembly that will decide the rules for free India. And the task was completed in November 1949. And on 26 November 1949, the Constitution of India was adopted. And it came into effect on 26th January 1950. What convinced Indians or the Constituent Assembly that the free India should be a democratic country? There was a reason behind it that when the Indians were under the British rule, Indians were forced to obey only those rules that they had very little role in making. The rules were made for India, but there was no role of Indians in forming those rules. That's why I explained you earlier also, only the rules which are accepted by the society with common consensus are the rules they feel free to obey. Britishers' rule was an authoritarian rule because they were not giving any space to Indians to form the rules or being the part of legislature. That's why their rule was an authoritarian rule. There was no voice in the legislature of the Indians. They struggled for the freedom and democracy. There was a sense of unity upon this idea that when India will become free, everyone should be treated equally and participate in the formation of government. That was not earlier, because no Indian was treated equally and there was no role of Indians in the formation of government. But making or the forming of constitution was not an easy task for the Constituent Assembly, because at that time India was facing so many problems. What were these problems? We are going to discuss in this part. What issues played on the minds of the members of the Constituent Assembly? The first and the foremost problem that we were facing at that time, that India is a diverse country that is made up of several different communities who spoke different languages, had distinct cultures and religions, and living together. It was not an easy task to make them convince for living and obey the rules made by the Constituent Assembly. The second problem was the partition of country into India and Pakistan on the basis of their religion. It means at that time India was facing such a big problem and it was not easy to convince those who living in India with different religions to follow the constitution. The third problem was some of the princely states remained undecided about their future, because when the Britishers decided to leave India, they left it to the rulers of the princely states to decide whether they wanted to merge with India or with Pakistan, or if they wanted to remain independent, they could. But the mergers of these princely states was a difficult and uncertain task at that time. The fourth problem was the socio-economic condition of the mass people living in India, because there was no industrialization, no education, and no development. That's why most of the people living in India were very poor, and their socio condition was also not good because there was untouchability and many other problems in India. Then how did the Constituent Assembly rise to these problems? They rose to this occasion very smartly. They showed extraordinary sense of unity when they were forming rules for India. Each of the provisions of the future constitution was discussed in great detail. Why there was a need to discuss these provisions in great detail? So that everybody could agree upon those rules without any question. Sincere efforts were made to compromise and reach an agreement through common consensus. The members of the Constituent Assembly were from different castes and different regions of India. That's why everybody could agree upon these rules through common consensus. They gave the country a visionary document that reflects a respect for maintaining diversity. Because I told you there was a social problem of untouchability, but the constitution gave fundamental rights to each and every citizen. They gave right to vote to all the Indians, and this was done to preserve national unity. It means they had respect for maintaining diversity. The final document also reflects their concern for eradicating poverty through socio-economic reforms. What socio-economic reforms were done by them? They gave reservation to the lower caste in parliament, in educational institutions, as well in jobs, so that they could improve their socio-economic reforms. And through the fundamental rights, they had already given them equality also. They emphasized the crucial role the people can play in choosing their representatives, because if the people choose their representatives, that will help them in future forming a type of society that will definitely help them in developing in future. The next we are going to discuss are the key features of Indian Constitution. The first feature of the Indian Constitution is of federalism. Federalism means when a country has more than one levels of government. Here in India, we have government at central level. At state level, we had state government. And at local level, we have Panchayati Raj system and the municipalities. Even the constitution contains lists, union lists, state list, and concurrent list to discuss in detail the issues that each tier of government can make laws on. It means each tier of government has been given particular powers and particular rights to make laws independently. They are not dependent on each other for forming laws. The constitution specifies where each tier of government can get the money from. Every tier of government need money to run or to govern the country. But if the government does not have money, it has to depend on the upper level of government to govern. And it means it is not ruling independently, but through forming the union list, state list, and the concurrent list, the Indian constitution clearly mentions what type of revenues will get which government. It means they have their independent role in governing. The states are not merely agents of federal government. I have already explained you that in the federal government, each tier of government is free to form their own laws and have their own resources of money. All persons are governed by laws. No one is supreme before the law, or no one is superior, I can say. And all the policies and the laws are made by these governments. The second feature of the Indian Constitution is it is a parliamentary form of government. In parliamentary form of government, all the levels of government consist of elected representatives. As you know, our parents participate in the elections of MPs and MLAs. It means they are electing their representatives. The Constitution guarantees universal adult suffrage to all the Indians who are above the age of 18. Universal means every person in India, adult who is above the age of 18, has been given the right to vote, irrespective of their language, their culture, their gender. Every citizen can contest in elections. In presidential type of government, the head of the government is president, and in parliamentary form of government, the head of the government is the prime minister. Here in India, the head of the government is prime minister. That's why we are following the parliamentary form of government. Every citizen in India can contest in election. The third feature of the Indian Constitution is the separation of powers. There are three organs of the government. The first one is legislature, who make laws for the country. The executives, who execute those policies made by the legislature. And the judiciary has its own role to check on the misuse of power by these legislature and executives. What is the role of legislature? They are the elected representatives and form the laws for the country. The executives are the parts of legislature. They are responsible for implementing those laws made by the legislature and running the government. The judiciary has its own independent role to prevent the misuse of the power that the legislature and the executives have. Each of these organs exercise different powers and control each other's power. That's why each organ acts as a check on the other organs of the government and ensures the balance of power, that no one can misuse its power. The fourth feature of the Indian Constitution, the fundamental rights. Here, the part third of Indian Constitution, from Article 12 to 35, give rights to all the Indians living in India, or you can say all the citizens of India. These rights are known as the conscience of the Constitution. These rights protect the government against the arbitrary rule or uncontrollable rule and absolute exercise of power by the state. Because through these fundamental rights, no one is allowed to interfere or to take these rights from any citizen. These rights guarantee the rights of individuals against the state. It means neither the state nor other individuals can take these rights from any citizen. That's why Dr. B.R. Ambedkar says that the fundamental rights have twofold objectives. The first one is every citizen must be in a position to claim those rights, because these are the rights given to each and every citizen. It means they can claim these rights when the state does not give these rights to them. The second, the rights must be binding upon every authority that has got the power to make laws. What fundamental rights have been given by the Constitution of India? There are six fundamental rights that I have told you from Article 12 to 35 in Part 3 of the Constitution. The first right is right to equality. It means everybody is equal before law. They are equal on the basis of their religion, caste, and gender. The second right is right to freedom. Everybody is free in India to speak, to express his or her views, to form associations, to move free, to reside in any part of the country, and practice any profession or occupation he wants. The third right is right against exploitation. It means if there is anybody who is being exploited, especially children and women, the Indian Constitution, these fundamental rights prohibit human trafficking, the buying and selling of human being, and they are not allowed to force anybody for labor, and they are not allowed to employ the children below the age of 14. The Indians also have been given the right to freedom of religion. They are free to practice any religion they want, to profess and propagate the religion they want. The fifth one is cultural and educational rights, because in India, different cultures and different people are living, people of different religions are living. That's why they may feel insecure or weaker section of the society. That's why the Indian Constitution has given all the minorities, religious or linguistic groups, that they can set up their own educational institutions to preserve and develop their own culture. No one will stop them from doing this. The last right of the Indian Constitution is right to constitutional remedies. The five above mentioned rights which have been given by the Indian Constitution, if anybody in the country or the living in country or the state does not give them those rights, the people are allowed, the citizens, to move to the court. That's why this right has been called the heart and soul of the Constitution, because if this right is not given to the citizens, there is no value of the rights above mentioned, because only this right gives the right to citizens to go to court if any of their right is violated by the Constitution, by the citizens of the country. Along with this, the Constitution of India also have given some directive principles of state policy that the state has to follow. It is like a guideline to the state to ensure greater social and economic reforms for the weaker section of society that will help the weaker section to improve their condition in future, and to serve as a guide to the Indian state to institute laws and policies in favor of the weaker section and to reduce poverty from the country. The fifth and the last feature we are going to discuss is India is a secular country. Secular means the state does not officially promote any one religion as the state religion. As I told you, there are many people living in India who belong to different religions. It may create a problem for Indians if the Indian Constitution favor any of the religion. That's why the Indian people do not, the Constitution does not allow the state to promote or to favor any of the religion. At last, I would like to Say, what is the difference between state or government? Here we have used both these words in this chapter, but the government means the elected representatives of the country. They are responsible for administering and enforcing laws. And the government can change with elections, but if we talk about the state, state is a political institution that does not change. The state represents a sovereign people who are living in that particular country, within the boundary of that country, who occupy a definite territory. For example, we can say the Indian state, the Nepali state, or the Chinese state. But I told you, as the state does not change with time, but the government can. State is a larger term, broader term, and the government is a less wider term. Only this much for today. We will meet you with some more explanations in the coming videos.